August 1990. Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein ignites a global crisis when he orders 500,000 soldiers to invade neighboring Kuwait. Encouraged by the American president, the United Nations demands an end to the aggression.
We seek the immediate, unconditional, and complete withdrawal of all Iraqi forces from Kuwait.
When Saddam Hussein defies the ultimatum, the UN unleashes the might and power of its multinational coalition.
Our strategy to go after this army is very, very simple. First, we're going to cut it off, and then we're going to kill it.
Operation Desert Storm, with the UN's overwhelming display of advanced weaponry, is televised live around the world. The cameras expose the vulnerability of Saddam Hussein's once proud Republican Guard. The UN follows up its decisive air campaign with a lightning advance by its ground forces. After 43 days, the Gulf War is over. Kuwaiti forces, having been routed by the Iraqi army, now return to their embattled capital.
Seven months ago, America and the world drew a line in the sand. We declared that the aggression against Kuwait would not stand. And tonight, America and the world have kept their word.
Operation Desert Storm is celebrated as a triumphant moment. A man whom political opponents describe as being born with a silver foot in his mouth, the Yankee blue blood turned Texan George Bush, initially emerges from Desert Storm with the aura of a great leader. He fails, however, to topple the regime of Saddam Hussein. In the wake of the giant flames and enormous smoke clouds that darken the skies over Kuwait, it is Saddam's shadow that lengthens, casting a pall across the rest of the 1990s. The 90s are a decade of bizarre events, from Waco to Oklahoma City, from Hope, Arkansas, to the hallways off the Oval Office, from O.J. Simpson to the death of a princess. But it is also the decade when democracy spreads across Eastern Europe and South Africa. And it is the flourishing of that democracy which makes this a decade to celebrate. The election of 46-year-old Bill Clinton in 1992, the rock and roll generation is on its way to the White House. The baby boomers remind America that yesterday is gone. The third youngest elected president models himself after the most youthful of all. In 1963, the teenager Bill Clinton meets President Kennedy in the White House Rose Garden. Clinton is a delegate to a government study program sponsored by the Boys Nation. Some 30 years later, he returns to Washington with his wife, Hillary, to assume the leadership of the country. Bill Clinton is the first baby boomer to become president of the United States. Born after the end of World War II, he brings to the nation's capital a youthful vigor not seen since the days of his idol, John F. Kennedy. Like President Kennedy, he promises change and new directions. This president, however, was a teenager in the 1960s. He does things other presidents born during different eras would never do, like playing the saxophone on television talk shows and discussing his underwear on MTV. Like all presidents, Bill Clinton will reaffirm Thomas Jefferson's maxim that no one carries out of the presidency the reputation that carries him into it. At the outset, he envisions a compassionate government that will feel the pain of its people. But his vision is quickly tarnished by a botched government raid in Waco, Texas, when the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Agency attempts to seize illegal weapons hoarded by a sect called the Branch Davidians. Violence ensues. 5 Davidians and 4 agents are killed. This is followed by a tense 51-day siege of the compound. It ends tragically on April the 19th, 1993. Over 80 men, women, and children perish as the compound erupts in flames. The FBI claims the Davidians are responsible and have committed mass suicide. Others believe the government is to blame. On the second anniversary of the Waco tragedy, a federal building in Oklahoma City is destroyed. A massive explosion kills over 160 people and wounds hundreds more.
Boy, it's just like an atomic bomb went off. The ceiling went in, all the windows came in, and it was a deafening roar, and then there's just dust and everything.
Evidence suggests that the bombing is a retaliatory blow against the government for its actions at Waco. Still, in the face of this horror, the resilience of the families and friends of the victims touches the nation.
What you have done has demonstrated to a watching and often weary and cynical world that good can overcome evil, that love can outlast hate, that the light of human life can shine on through the most terrible darkness.
Clinton's presidency is an embattled one. The first family faces a barrage of ordeals, yet they seem to weather every storm. Bill and Hillary Clinton, says a friend, think each other is the brightest person they know. Hillary Rodham Clinton becomes a politically active first lady. She is given the task of remaking America's faltering health care system. In doing so, she comes up against powerful insurance companies and a partisan Congress. Her efforts fail when she is unable to chart a successful course through the political maze. The defeat comes against the backdrop of a growing investigation into the Clintons' personal investments. In 1993, questions arise about real estate ventures in Arkansas 20 years before. A special prosecutor, Kenneth Starr, is appointed to probe the Clintons' investments in the Whitewater Development Corporation. The term Whitewater becomes part of the national lexicon. But the Clintons assert they have nothing to hide.
I tried to be as helpful as I could in their investigation efforts.
The prolonged scrutiny of this investigation ultimately reveals a secret that threatens to destroy Bill Clinton's presidency. The machinery of American democracy comes face to face with sex, lies, and audio tapes. In January 1999 with the impeachment and the acquittal. It becomes a national soap opera the year before, when Bill Clinton's private conduct becomes a public issue. When Special Prosecutor Kenneth Starr widens his ongoing Whitewater investigation, he uncovers evidence of a secret relationship between the president and a young White House intern, Monica Lewinsky. More significantly, Starr later alleges that Clinton obstructed justice by lying to a grand jury and trying to cover it up.
I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. I never told anybody to lie, not a single time, never.
The public debate over what is or isn't true rages as the Star investigation continues. The nation is titillated by the scandal's salacious details. Public opinion polls reveal that most Americans believe that there was a relationship. But they also believe that even if Clinton lied, his actions do not warrant removal from office. There is a call for congressional censure. In 1999, the House of Representatives determines otherwise. Bill Clinton becomes only the second American president, after Andrew Johnson, to be impeached. In the Senate, following constitutional procedure, he is tried and acquitted. There is also no congressional censure. The year-long crisis leaves America drained and the president repentant.
I want to say again to the American people how profoundly sorry I am for what I said and did to trigger these events and the great burden they have imposed on the Congress and on the American people.
During the summer of 1998, two gifted ball players divert America's attention from the presidential sex scandal. The home run duel between Mark McGwire of the St. Louis Cardinals and Sammy Sosa of the Chicago Cubs electrifies even some who don't normally care about such things. Both men break Roger Maris' 37-year-old record of 61 home runs in a single season. In their own exciting race for the year's home run title, McGwire prevails with 70. Sosa hits 66. In an era of trash talk and arrogant posturing, these two soft-spoken stars bring a simple dignity to sports in the 90s. In basketball, Michael Jordan also sets new and phenomenal standards by which other players will be measured. In an age when professional athletes rarely play for one team for any length of time, Jordan achieves his greatness in one city. Chicago. In the old days, it was the city where Al Capone, the most notorious gangster of all time, shot and killed people. In the 1990s, it is the home of professional basketball's Chicago Bulls and Michael Jordan. Jordan is one of the most famous people in the world, and unquestionably the best basketball player ever. He's called Air because he spends an unusual amount of his time in the air. Rarely have grace and mental toughness been fused so magnificently in one athlete. In his 13 pro seasons, he leads the Bulls to 6 world titles. 6 times he is named the championship series' most valuable player. Possessing an unassuming charm, Jordan achieves his mythic status almost solely through his phenomenal athleticism. The star, who Fortune magazine says added $10 billion to the economy, attracts the kind of following usually reserved for presidents and movie idols. His celebrity transcends sports and rivals that of one of the century's most outspoken superstars.
Oh, look out for that toy step, Doc. It's a real Lulu.
Bugs Bunny?
You were expecting maybe the Easter Bunny?
You're a cartoon. You're not real.
Not real, eh? If I weren't real, could I do this?
In 1998, Jordan blows a farewell kiss to his career at the NBA Finals. In the waning seconds of his life on the court, he displays the strength of his champion's heart. It is this same invincibility of spirit that 4'9" Kerry Strug displays at the Olympic Games in Atlanta. In the women's team gymnastics competition, she severely sprains her ankle and suffers torn ligaments on the first of her 2 vaults.
And I heard a pop after the first vault, so I knew something was wrong, but I didn't really know what, and just, you know, had to take it from there.
Kerry is told that the team gold medal rests upon her 88-pound frame. Despite her injuries, she makes her second vault. By risking further injury, she sacrifices her own chance for an individual gold medal. Kerry's selflessness helps the United States win Olympic gold for the first time in the women's gymnastics team event. Earlier in the decade, one of the preeminent sports figures of the century is embroiled in a shocking and disillusioning saga. In 1994, the College and Professional Hall of Fame football star O.J. Simpson is accused of the vicious murder of his ex-wife Nicole and her friend Ron Goldman. The world's television crews and press descend on the Los Angeles courthouse where Simpson has assembled a so-called dream team of defense lawyers.
Not guilty.
For 9 months, the divisive and racially charged trial is played out in front of a sequestered jury and an international television audience. Simpson's defense charges a police frame-up, claiming that evidence, like the DNA samples, are tainted. The murder glove, which the prosecutor says is Simpson's, provides the trial with one of its most dramatic moments.
Do the right thing, remembering that if it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
Orenthal James Simpson, case number BA-097.
Finally, the verdict.
We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant Orenthal James Simpson not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of Penal Code Section 187.
The verdict stuns millions, but is applauded by O.J.'s unwavering fans. Later, however, he will be found liable for the murders in a civil trial and ordered to pay $33.5 million in damages. Unlike the Simpson ordeal, some media spectacles in the 90s uplift and inspire. The World Cup in Italy, watched by 347 million, is a showcase for much more than soccer. In honor of the World Cup, Maestro Zubin Mehta presides as the three tenors, Pavarotti, Carreras, and Domingo, celebrate the harmony of the human heart. As the decade begins, the Soviet leader, Mikhail Gorbachev, desperately clings to his job. He is walking a tightrope, trying to balance the forces of reform and the forces of nationalism. After almost 6 years in power, he is still trying to save the Communist Party and yet move dramatically toward democracy. In the 90s, he struggles to hold the Soviet Union together. All 15 Soviet republics demand sovereignty. From Estonia to Uzbek, they demand independence. In the Soviet Union self-destructing, Gorbachev barely survives a coup in August of 1991. He is placed under house arrest while on vacation in the Crimea. It is Boris Yeltsin who rallies the people of Moscow against the hardline communists who want to crush Gorbachev's democratic movement. Denouncing the coup as a cynical move by the army and the KGB, he inspires the people to set up barricades of parked buses to stop the tanks and troops. The conspirators cannot prevail against the spirited resistance of the people of Moscow. When Gorbachev returns from the Crimea, he is slow to respond to Yeltsin's demands to close down the Communist Party. Trying to hang on to the remnants of his past, he cannot hang on to his job. In December, he resigns as the Soviet Union completely disbands. The red flag is lowered over the Kremlin. After 74 years of being the center of an empire, the Soviet Union is no more. Boris Yeltsin is the new leader, not of the old Soviet Union, but of the 147 million people in one of its former states, Russia. Yeltsin steadfastly resists Communist Party involvement in his new government. Overweight, sickly, and said to have a drinking problem, Yeltsin moves unsteadily towards a free market economy. He makes a manifest effort to connect with the West. He needs an infusion of Western money to stabilize the Russian ruble.
Avoid the mass washing.
There are, however, instability and hardships. Turmoil follows in the wake of too much expectation. The Russian people suffer disappointment after disappointment. As Yeltsin's own health fails, so too does the nation's, physically as well as economically. The death rate increases. In 1999, life expectancy in Russia falls to levels lower than in many developing countries, including Mexico. It is estimated that every year 700,000 more Russians die than are born. In addition, Yeltsin must address another demand for autonomy. This time, it's a region that is historically a part of the state of Russia. The Muslim-dominated area known as Chechnya wants to secede. Yeltsin sends in 40,000 troops. The word quagmire is heard once again in the 20th century. Yeltsin, undergoing bypass surgery and long hospital stays, maintains a shaky control over the government. In 7 years, he goes through six prime ministers. Control over the former Soviet Union's large stockpile of nuclear weapons is now divided. Yeltsin remains in charge of those located in Russia. The new leaders of Belarus and the Ukraine now control the atomic arsenals located within their boundaries. As the century comes to an end, the further proliferation of nuclear weapons becomes one of the world's most urgent problems. Fears that rogue nations like Iran and Iraq are either in possession of or are developing atomic weaponry trouble the world's democracies. When Saddam Hussein expels United Nations weapons inspection teams, there is swift retaliatory action. The Chinese government, like all other nations, claims nuclear weapons are only for deterrence. In 1999, they are accused by the United States of stealing designs for an advanced miniature nuclear warhead. Spying does not provide the Chinese with parity in atomic weapons. Its stockpile is dwarfed by America's. Its efforts to develop long-range missiles threaten to subvert its developing relationship with Washington. After Deng Xiaoping's death in 1997, the new Chinese leadership continues to pursue ties with the Clinton administration. Earlier, the Chinese take another giant step into the world of free markets when they finally re-annex Asia's foremost citadel of capitalism, Hong Kong. Ceded to Britain by the Qing dynasty in 1842, Hong Kong is returned to China amidst a festive celebration. Thus does Britain relinquish another jewel in its waning colonial empire. During the 20th century, England has surrendered 5.5 million square miles of its colonies. 800 million people are no longer ruled by the British Crown. Star Wars, the prequel, opens in 1999. Since 1977, when Luke Skywalker first went in search of his destiny, a legion of fans, fanatics, and consumers have made the Force more than just a movie.
Anakin Skywalker, meet Obi-Wan Kenobi.
American movies dominate the world scene. National identities are eclipsed by the ever-increasing flow of film from the USA. It has been happening since World War II, when American GIs were the first to export American lifestyles and American products to Europe. Baseball, chewing gum, Coca-Cola, and hamburgers. But what they brought is nothing compared to what the consumer society and the communication revolution has achieved. There are those who resist it and those who deplore it. But more and more, the world drinks, dances, and dresses like Americans. Even a former Soviet leader does television commercials for an American product.
Горбачев, из-за него мы на краю экономической пропасти.
Да благодаря ему у нас свобода.
Из-за него мы на краю политического хаоса.
Благодаря ему мы теперь свободны. И можем дойти до края этой пиццы.
За Горбачева!
За Горбачева!
За Горбачева!
За Горбачева!
The American presence in the world is felt most noticeably in music. Around the world, they weep, they swoon, they scream. There's nothing like it. It's called Michaelmania. It happens on every continent, and it has been happening for almost two decades. The king of pop, Michael Jackson, has staying power. In Sarajevo, the capital city of Bosnia, in what was once known as Yugoslavia, a young girl, Zlata Filipovic, writes in her diary, December 4th, 1991, I'm eating a pizza and listening to Michael Jackson. Every night I dream that I'm asking Michael for his autograph. In another entry, she writes, I really am crazy. I'm going to try to join Madonna's fan club. She's not unlike an 11-year-old girl in America. But suddenly, that all changes.
What I tell you, every child from Sarajevo can tell you. They had normal childhood. They had birds. They had music, sun. And just one day, everything disappeared.
Zlata writes in her diary that there's a real war going on. People are dying. What on earth is happening? What is happening is a fierce revival of nationalism and religious separatism. It begins in Croatia and Bosnia-Herzegovina when they declare their independence from Greater Yugoslavia. Serbia, the largest of the Yugoslav states, attacks in full force to prevent the country's breakup. Slavic Christians take up arms against Muslims. In 1992, the world learns of the first concentration camps on European soil since World War II. A ruthless and barbaric ethnic cleansing is well underway. Zlata's diary, like Anne Frank's in Amsterdam almost 50 years earlier, chronicles stories of oppression. Our awful cellar is the only place that can save our lives. Everything is being destroyed, she writes. Sarajevo is slowly dying. Life is disappearing. My friend Nina is dead. A shell fell in the park outside my house, and a piece of shrapnel lodged in her brain. Everybody is gone. I can't take it anymore. After 3 years of bloodshed and turmoil, the West finally intervenes. The might of United Nations and NATO forces pours into the Balkans. Eventually, they force the warring leaders from the battlefield to the negotiating table. In Dayton, Ohio, they forge a treaty integrating Bosnia's warring factions. peace returns to the Balkans, and the Serbian leader, Slobodan Milosevic, is the key to its preservation.
About an hour ago, I spoke
with Secretary Christopher
in Dayton, Ohio.
President Clinton declares the negotiations a success.
The presidents of Bosnia, Croatia, and Serbia have reached a peace agreement to end the war in Bosnia.
To keep the fragile peace, Clinton deploys American troops in Bosnia. At century's end, they're still there. Their presence, however, does not diffuse the incipient troubles that erupt in the nearby province of Kosovo. Kosovo is sacred ground to Yugoslavia's Christian Serbs, but 90% of its 2 million inhabitants are ethnic Albanians and religious Muslims. The Kosovars seek independence. In 1998, after years of simmering conflict, the Serbs launch a violent crusade to subdue what they call a terrorist insurrection.
All actions of Serbian police were only against terrorist groups.
The West, however, sees Milosevic as the true terrorist in Kosovo. His victims bear the scars of ethnic cleansing. Hundreds of thousands of refugees flee to neighboring countries. In March 1999, President Clinton and NATO determine they must stop Milosevic. Surgical airstrikes are deployed against Serbian positions. With little risk to their own forces, the NATO command begins a relentless daily attack. In many ways, the 20th century ends where it began, in the Balkans. It was in Sarajevo in August of 1914 that World War I started, with the killing of Austria's Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Again in the 1990s, the area becomes a potential flashpoint for a greater crisis. As the summer of 1999 begins, a tentative peace settlement seems possible. But the Balkans' historic volatility renders any settlement inconclusive. As this century ends, the world watches to see if the flames will flare up or be extinguished.
Nelson Mandela will be released on Sunday, the 11th of February, at about 3 p.m.
With Nelson Mandela's release from prison, democracy takes a bold step forward in South Africa. The symbol of his people's struggle for freedom, Mandela calls for reconstruction and reconciliation.
Amandla!
Amandla, e Africa, Mayebui. Power, Africa is ours. And so does the 71-year-old Nelson Mandela begin his first day outside prison walls in 27 years, speaking not only to the people in the Cape Town City Hall Square, but on television to millions around the globe. His almost three decades in prison has deepened his conviction that all people must live in harmony. The ideal of a democratic and free society, he says, is one that I am prepared to die for.
From this massive crowd, the government must now accept that we want peace standing on our feet, not kneeling on our knees.
In 1994, his passion yields results that a decade earlier would have seemed impossible. South Africa is reborn in free elections, and Mandela is elected president.
I, who hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa,
Will you please raise your right hand and say, so help me God.
So help me God.
He brings his nation out of the darkness of apartheid into the light of freedom. In 1993, there is also the promise of an end to the strife and warfare in the Middle East. Enough of blood, enough of tears, says Israel's Prime Minister, Yitzhak Rabin.
Is a remarkable progress towards tranquility, stability, and peace in the region.
Yasser Arafat, the head of the Palestinian Liberation Organization, agrees. For almost half a century, the two claimants to the land of Palestine have been embroiled in war and conflagration. Now, as a result of secret meetings in Norway, the PLO and Israel reach an historic agreement. In the Oslo Accords, the two sides agree to recognize each other's right to exist.
For this, we have spent all these nights and days. Look how many papers.
They agree to establish an interim Palestinian self-government in Gaza and parts of the West Bank. There is also a guarantee of elections in the future. Rabin, his defense minister Shimon Peres, and Arafat later meet in Washington to confirm and extend the agreements. November the 4th, 1995, 37 days after shaking hands with Arafat in Washington, D.C., Yitzhak Rabin is shot and killed by an Israeli right-wing extremist. The 20th century began with talk about building a homeland for the Jews in Uganda, in the middle of Africa. It ends with a Jewish homeland firmly rooted in Palestine. Alongside it today, for the first time since Israel's creation in 1948, is a self-administered Palestinian territory. Democracy continues to move forward. It is something only poets dreamt about, Yitzhak Rabin said of the Oslo Agreement. Impossible, he said, unthinkable even. Democracy prevailing.
It is announced from Buckingham Palace that, with regret, the Prince and Princess of Wales have decided to separate.
Princess Diana's fairy tale becomes a nightmare when her marriage to Prince Charles is shattered by his infidelity. In full view of the world, her life begins to unravel. Divorced at 35, Diana looks forward to a new life with her sons William and Harry, but she cannot help but look back.
We had struggled to keep it going, but obviously we'd both run out of steam. And in a way, I suppose it could have been a relief for us both that we'd finally made our minds up.
In the 90s, Diana uses the media to focus attention on the needs of others. She adds substance to her style and confirms her royal status. Diana's personal journey is covered extensively by the media. In 1997, they report she has found a new love interest in Dodi Al-Fayed. On August 31st, they die in a Paris car crash. For 6 days, the world is consumed with grief. No one, it seems, is untouched by the too early and too tragic death of Diana. She was only 36. Queen Elizabeth speaks for the world when she says no one will ever forget her. 20th century may well be the most momentous in the history of mankind. It certainly has been tumultuous. Some historians are calling it a brutal and bloody century of murder and atrocity. Others look beyond these crimes against humanity and call it a century of technological and political triumph. In the last 100 years, democracy, self-determination, freedom of the individual, human rights, has not only survived, it has expanded. Where once there were only a handful of democracies, there are today over 100. Democracy may be the most dramatic story to come out of the 20th century. It has been a journey fraught with danger and hairbreadth escapes. But finally, it has been a journey to celebrate. With the help of Louis Armstrong, we close this series with images of that fateful quest for democracy. These are pictures that can only embolden our yearnings for more of the same.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, bright blessed days, dark sacred nights. And I think to myself, and look a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the skies, also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? Babies cry. I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself,
finally, it is a century to celebrate.
What a wonderful...